Mike Andes is a young entrepreneur with a multi-million dollar business. You've probably heard of his name if you're a regular on the UpFlip channel. We've talked to Mike before about his landscaping business, and today we're back to check on his progress. You guys have asked for this video, and we've delivered. Mike Andes started mowing lawns at the age of 13 to pay his way through college. He started Augusta Lawn Care Services after graduating with an MBA and has grown his company to the seven figures at the age of 24.
I think what gets a business from zero to 100,000 is not the thing that's gonna get them from 100,000 to 500,000. So this kind of allows that growth trajectory to continue.
Today we'll get a firsthand look from Mike on how he's setting himself up for success. We'll also hear about his franchises and how they're doing and what he's doing to help them be set up for success.
Whereas this, we're literally half the length of this whole, you know, kind of setup. You've got to build a system that is worth an initial fee, worth a royalty.
One, the employee must be compensated like an owner, and two, they must have the information like an owner.
Mike's advice isn't just for landscapers. Any business owners from all kinds of industries can learn a lot by hearing what Mike is doing to set himself up for success and how he's growing his business. So make sure you like this video, subscribe to our channel. Let's go talk to Mike. All right, Mike, it's good to be back with you.
Absolutely.
We're gonna dive straight into it. Our viewers have asked for an update. We've interviewed you a year ago. So you guys, make sure you check out that video. We interviewed Mike almost, I think it's been more than a year. The link is gonna be in the description below. For those that don't know you, maybe this is the first episode you're watching, tell us a little bit about yourself and your landscaping business.
Yeah, so I started mowing lawns when I was 11 years old, kind of as a way to pay for college. Started college really young at 13 years old. I thought I was gonna go to medical school, but I ended up dropping out of med school and starting a lawn care business and really taking it big. Mm-hmm. So that was when I was 18 years old. Now, fast forward seven, 8 years later, we have grown Augusta Lawn Care into 37 locations around the country. And then landscapebusinesscourse.com is kind of where I do a lot of training and podcasts for other landscapers growing their companies.
Mike, what's changed since last year, since we've interviewed? How's your team grown, revenue? Let's talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, like locally, we acquired another local landscaper that wasn't doing so well. And so they've grown about 35% in the past year locally at this shop. The biggest change though has been the number of franchisees that we have. And my involvement with them is a lot more. And so we've gone from about 8 to 9 locations when you're here last to about 37 as of recent.
Wow, just within the last 12 months.
Yeah.
That's amazing growth. What about revenue though? Can we talk about that?
Yeah, what's so like that? Revenue locally, we went from about 1.15 last year to a little over 1.65 this year, locally at this shop.
That's
and
amazing.
Then from the franchise standpoint, it's a startup, right? And so right. A lot of those first year or two, we really are just trying to break even get to break even on our franchises. Everyone thinks franchising is so great, but mm-hmm. it's not a money grab for the first couple of years. It's definitely an expense. We lose money there. Mm-hmm. But definitely from a revenue standpoint, we went from probably about 100,000 in 2019 to about 500,000 from the franchise level. And again, that's gonna grow exponentially just because as we bring more and more on, and they are growing as well.
What does it take to open a franchise? Is there a particular budget involved in getting your first one? I'm sure people just want to hear about that.
Yeah, I think that really ties into how are you going to get your first one? Mm-hmm. Like it's so nice to think about, oh, I'm just going to franchise my business, I'm going to sell my business model, but what are you selling? Is it any benefit to somebody other than them just starting themselves? And I think like literally 80% of franchises never sell more than one location.
Why is that?
And that's because a lot of people think that if they franchise their business, they'll build it and they will come. It's not that way. You've got to build a system that is worth an initial fee, worth a royalty, worth those extra costs and the limitations that come with a franchise.
So for somebody watching, maybe he's just starting out, maybe he thinks he's got a great business model plan and he's thinking, man, I got a franchise. What would you tell him? Because it sounds like that may not be the time to do it.
I would say start a second location, start mm-hmm. a third location, and you're gonna start to find the holes in your business model that would otherwise be someone else on their dime figuring out those problems.
Right.
And you don't want that as a franchisor, where your franchisees are failing because you simply did not get all the holes plugged in the business model.
So talking about those holes and finding them by opening up a second location, third location before you start franchising, what are some examples in your business that has helped?
Yeah, for like lawn care landscaping, a big part of overhead is just the administrative side of things, the office, you know, doing the stuff paperwork, invoicing, billing, answering phone calls. So something that we did was start a command center, we call it. It's like a fancy call center where we send out estimates for the clients, to the clients from the franchisees, and do a lot of their office work for them.
Okay. Is that something you think we could go take a tour of and check it out?
Yeah, just a few minutes away. We can go check it out now.
Guys, let's go check out the command center and see how things are happening on the go. Let's just hop into my car and Tesla out of here. All right, guys, we're here in Ferndale. The Augusta Lawn Care Services Call Center, the command center right there, right, Mike?
Yes, sir.
All right, let's go check it out. Mike, tell us about the purpose, the goal, intent of what's really going on here at the command center.
Yeah, like as a lawn care business grows and it kind of gets too busy on the office side of things for just the owner, you know, $300,000-$500,000 annual revenue, that's when you kind of need an office person. Mm-hmm. But it's a large overhead expense to get a lease, have internet, have utilities, all of those things that come with hiring an office person, getting computers. And so that is a big jump in overhead expense for a lawn care business. So our goal here is they only get charged by the minute of use. So they can kind of slowly grow into using an office person and kind of delegating those administrative roles.
And those are the holes we were talking about, right?
Exactly. Like
the one guy who thinks he's got everything ready to go, not the time to start the franchise.
And a lot of times people get to $300,000-$400,000 in revenue and then they have to retreat back because they're getting so busy with calls and estimates and all the office work, but yet they don't make enough to go out and get an office and hire a person and have the software and the computers and all the rest of it. Okay. So this kind of allows that growth trajectory to continue.
Yeah, excited. Let's check it out, you guys. I see a lot of trailers and trucks in the back. Really curious, how many do you have at this point? I mean, you've grown significantly.
Yeah, like the local shop here, this is our first location. Uh-huh. We now have about 15 vehicles here, and we really are switching to a trailerless setup. It's kind of a big improvement since you came last. A lot of it actually comes out of Paul Akers, Kaizen, lean thinking, all that stuff is, we practice that here. And it kind of comes full circle with everything at UpFlip. And even you can see here, we have two enclosed trailers that used to be four or five, and we're reducing that and making more of a trailerless setup where you don't have to have a trailer. Little improvements like that, even in lawn care and landscaping, yes, it works on a manufacturing floor, but it also works in a service-based business like this.
So trailer's no good in the long run.
It's harder to train people. Like most people, new hires coming in, entry-level workers, and even with COVID, seeing so many displaced workers at that entry-level position in the form of airlines, restaurants, et cetera, you gotta be able to take that workforce and train them very efficiently if you're gonna make them profitable. And adding a trailer, having a bigger truck, more equipment, only adds to that learning curve for them and therefore reduces our profitability.
So tell us about what Rachel specifically is doing right now as far as, I see she's texting, answering phone calls, being really interesting to see.
Yeah, so let's go talk to her. This is Rachel. She's been with us for several years.
Hi.
She's awesome. And so right now, just maybe tell them a little bit what you're doing, who you're texting, kind of what your process is.
Yeah, so I'm currently texting one of the franchisee owner's wives, and she just has a couple of questions about the payment process. So I'm just helping her out with setting up her billing terms. She had a couple of questions about full service, so I'm just answering some of those things as well.
Cool. Yeah, so the calls will come in here, and then really whoever is available, they can pick them up right away. And so the headsets allow them to kind of focus on doing that, but then also the franchisees can text them directly about things in the office, things that a billing issue or a customer having a problem or an estimate being accepted. They can do direct communication with them here.
That's awesome. What app are you using for the texting and maybe phone call?
Currently we're upgrading that system of the business. We're going from Grasshopper to Ring Central.
Okay.
Ring Central is going to allow us to scale here at the command center a lot larger. Grasshopper has been what we've used in the past.
Okay, so Grasshopper for calling and texting, but
it's
you're scaling to...
It's a great place to start for a new entrepreneur, small business, have one or two lines, but now we have 40 some odd phone numbers. It's a lot harder to kind of keep it all organized. So we're now switching over to Ring Central.
Awesome. What other improvements have you made that had a direct impact on operations, revenue, in a very positive way?
Yeah, we actually talked about it last time I was here a little bit. That's simplification of services. So instead of offering $100,000 paver patios that you need very skilled labor, it's expensive, you need bigger trucks, a lot of planning, a lot more management involved, we really focus on those simple services, the recurring maintenance, the mowing, the weeding, the bush trimming. You can teach it a lot faster, and you can make systems around it much easier because it's not one-off jobs.
So you get rid of the big stuff, essentially.
We do, yeah. We've turned away, last winter, we turned away a job that was over $100,000, a massive paver job, but we've learned our lesson. We've had the times where we've tried those, and they don't work out so well when you're trying to focus on those simple services. Mm. And when it comes to hiring people in this labor market, that's the hardest part for this industry. You got to have simple services to be able to bring someone that's entry-level and quickly make them profitable.
If I think to myself, I have a business and somebody offers me a $100,000 job, it would be hard to say no. So what's the lesson in that, saying no and actually understanding that that's a good thing for your business?
It's the biggest lesson that this industry really needs to figure out. A large $100,000 job does not mean $100,000 profit. And it definitely doesn't mean that you're gonna make that $100,000 every month or every year. There's no consistency in a one-off project. And that's what COVID really hit at the very beginning, was those big projects. And when we saw in the recession, 2007, 2008, same thing. I'm looking for that dependable stream of income that can slowly build. It's recurring. I know it's coming today, tomorrow, next week, next month, next year, and I can build a sustainable business.
Do you mind if we go check out one of those trucks?
Absolutely, yeah. I'll show you around a little bit.
Because we're looking at a trailer. This is where you put all your stuff, but now we're seeing a truck. No need for a trailer.
Right.
Efficiency, Kaizen. You guys make sure you check out those videos. The link is going to be in the description below, or just check out our whole channel. But we talk about it all the time, and this is amazing. I mean, this is the result.
If you look at like an enclosed trailer, like the ones over there, those are 7x14. They usually are gonna have a bigger mower on there. A lot more equipment can fit inside of there.
Right.
But the problem is every morning you gotta hitch that trailer up. At the end of the day, you gotta unhook that trailer.
Right.
Whereas this, we're literally half the length of this whole, you know, kind of setup. And what's cool is you can still get a mower in here. You can literally pull this down.
It's not that heavy, okay. So you can
just
do
like
it
this,
alone.
It's all spring loaded. You can drive your mower up into here. And then this is a new little feature, again, kind of a lean improvement, you might call it.
This thing right here?
Where a wheel of the mower can get locked up in here. So that way when they put the mower in here, it's not moving around. And it's very quick access to get outside of the truck and the trailer. So all the racks up here are for the different pieces of equipment.
Man.
Again, being able to just quickly get in here every single day. It's all locked up when they come here in the morning. They can just drive right out.
And this is from armored lock protection, I see.
But I'm
sure there's other options.
Trailer
out there.
Racks, there's a whole bunch of different ones. This is the ramp rack here. But trying to reduce every single moment and time, just like Paul Akers was saying, like a couple seconds here, a couple seconds there.
Right.
Trying to get them out early in the morning. And more importantly, trying to make systems in your business where getting entry-level employees up to speed and profitable is reduced.
Lots of companies follow certain procedures and then they fail. Why does that happen, do you think? Give us one or two tips of advice. Why do you think they fail?
I think what gets a business from zero to 100,000 is not the thing that's gonna get them from 100,000 to 500,000. What gets them to 500,000 is not gonna be the thing that gets them to a million.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you look at your goals and how big you wanna grow your business, you gotta realize you're gonna have to change, you're gonna have to evolve, you're gonna have to grow. What gets you to 100,000? Sales, we talked about that.
Mm-hmm.
But you're gonna have to change your management style if you're
from
gonna 100. Build a team and grow the business. So in my opinion, it's failure to adapt to what the business needs to make the appropriate changes for growth.
Yeah, it's interesting how in our adaptable world, some people have a hard time doing it.
Absolutely.
But
well, you know what? Why don't we actually take you to a job site?
Okay.
And you can kind of see the team in action. I have no
idea.
Are
they there now?
Yeah, like I don't know anything about this job. Again, I don't run day-to-day operations, but we can go there now, check in with Aaron, who's probably working at the property now.
Yep.
See what they need.
And I'm sure our viewers want to do it. Guys, let's go. It's gonna be a real job site. You'll see how the operations happen. Tell us what your revenue is on this job, including payroll, after payroll, net, things like that.
Yeah, so I did not estimate the job. Obviously, we have estimators and office staff, so I have no idea in one regard.
Okay.
But I know, but based upon the 4 budgeted hours that I did see on this project, I know that we got 4 hours of budgeted labor.
Mm-hmm.
So let's multiply that by $70. So right there's $280.
Okay.
Then you're gonna have dump fees. So you can see all the debris in the back of his truck there. That's gonna cost per truckload. So they're gonna charge $99 if he fills that thing up.
If he fills it up. But if he doesn't, how do you fraction
it's already
that out?
Pre-done. So the estimator's already determined how much debris he's gonna haul away. The customer's already accepted a specific price.
Gotcha.
So it's all set. There's no like, oh, if you fill up half, we charge 50. Like that's
mm-hmm.
not happening.
Mm-hmm.
And so on a job like this for Aaron, he's gonna bring in $280 worth of revenue labor-wise, mm-hmm. and he's gonna get one third of that.
He's gonna get one
P for P right there. This is P for P in action.
Okay.
So if he gets it done in probably 2.5, 3, he's going to make the equivalent as if you would have done four.
I don't fully understand how you work the P for P. So mm-hmm. 280, he gets one third of that. Would he get less if he finishes it longer?
Doesn't matter how long it takes, right?
But he gets paid hourly as well then.
No, so at the end of the day with P for P, at the end of the pay period, they make a base amount. Like they won't go lower than a certain floor.
I see.
Right? And for us, that's $18 per hour. But for what we're doing here today, for example, if he gets this done in 3 hours, let's do the math. So 280 is total labor revenue.
Okay.
We divide that by three. He's going to make about $90 on this job.
On top of the 18.
No. At the end of the paycheck, we just make sure they make at least that.
Okay.
If they're underperforming. But at the end of the day, like, you know, he could make $25 an hour if he goes fast. Now, if he goes really, really slow and it takes him 6 hours, he's still getting $90.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And in that case, that's when the $18 per hour would actually kick in.
Gotcha. Did you know that slow-loading websites cost retailers $2.6 billion in lost sales each year? So if you've got a business and a poorly designed website, you're losing a ton of money. Get your website reevaluated. See if it's losing money by going to one of our sponsors' website, modernwebmedia.com/upflip. One of their clients increased their sales by $28,000 in the first 3 months of working with them. They'll also give you a 25% discount on all of their web design packages if you use our promo code UpFlip25. So do yourself and your business a huge favor. Get your site reevaluated and redesigned by Modern Web Media. Are you guys thinking of opening up your own franchise? Let us know if you want us to do a dedicated episode specifically about franchising. Make sure you comment below. We'll read them, we'll respond, and we'll get it done for you guys. Let's dive into marketing approach. How's that changed over the last year for you, and what's your current budget? How are you using it? Maybe go from there.
Yeah, for the local office, like when it comes to the individual location that's doing the mowing and doing the landscaping, they're usually going to spend between 1% and 2% of revenue unless they're growing really, very quickly. Like they're just getting started, they're going to spend a lot more than that. Maybe $100 a day when they're first getting started as a budget for mm-hmm. marketing. That's going to allow for a lot of growth and scale. When it comes to the franchise, in terms of what we're doing here, we really don't spend any money on marketing or ads necessarily. We do more or less focus on creating content. Content marketing is what it's called, to really generate the leads for the franchise.
Let's elaborate on that, because maybe people haven't heard that phrase, content marketing. What is that exactly? And how do we scale it? How do we scale our business based on that?
Yeah, like I really believe content marketing is the place to be at, because you create the content, you create an audience, you build trust with that audience, and then when they come to you to buy whatever product or service you're offering, they've already developed that relationship with you. And that's the biggest hurdle in any sale, is developing that trust, developing that rapport. And that can be done now through a camera, it can be done through a microphone, and it can be done to at scale to tens of thousands of people. And so through Landscape Business Course, the books, the things that I try to make for the industry, they usually come to me already knowing what we're all about, already ready to buy in, and there is no advertising that we actually spend in terms of like trying to convince them to come in.
For people looking to start this business, do you think it makes sense to get into a franchise or start it independently? What are the pros and cons?
I think for a lot of people, independently is not a bad option. And you know, coming from someone who has a franchise, that seems weird to say, but a lot of times an entrepreneur who wants to figure out things by themselves, they need to start independently. Because a franchise is going to limit some of your creativity. We tell you what color to paint your trucks. We tell you what software to use. We tell you what systems to use. And for some people, they like that structure. For other people, they want to figure out things on their own. And I think that's fine, mm-hmm. right? I think the franchise is going to be good for someone that wants the systems, wants to grow faster, and not figure out things by themselves. It's right. saving time, right? It took me probably 7 or 8 years to really figure out the 3 days of training that we do now for our franchisees. So there's definitely a learning curve that is, you know, negated when you have a franchise. But honestly, for some people, if they're a real entrepreneur and they just want to figure things out, it's not a bad thing to start independently.
Gotcha. Well, from starting a business to maybe your first $100,000, wouldn't you achieve it faster via franchise than trying to figure it out on your own? Any connections there?
I don't think so, the first 100,000 actually, because if I was going to go to a franchise, I would have to spend a franchise fee. So for us, it's 15,000. That's a significant amount of money. Mm-hmm. And I don't think if someone's trying to get to 100,000, that best use of that $15,000 is spending it on a franchise fee. It would be go use it on marketing, right? So, but most people don't join a franchise with, oh, I want to get to 100,000. I want to get to 1 million, and to get from 100,000 to 1 million, you have to have a completely different business with systems, lean thinking,
right,
management in place, you know, operating software, all of that sort of thing is what's going to get you to the bigger business. And most people joining a franchise, that's what they're after.
I want to go back for just a second and reiterate the costs of starting a franchise.
The main thing with any franchise, you're going to have an initial fee, mm-hmm, and then you're going to have a royalty. And so that's the two major costs you're going to have that are involved. And in some franchises, they make, you know, hundreds of thousands on initial fee if you're buying to a massive franchise. But for us, it's $15,000 due to the initial fee. And then for us, we've changed the model with the royalty. We don't charge a percentage of your revenue. That's usually what a royalty fee is.
Right.
We charge a flat monthly fee of $1,200. And so that covers all the systems, access to everything we've talked about. And so the two things, if you're looking to get into a franchise, is startup cost is going to involve your initial fee and then whatever equipment you got to get going, as well as your startup capital for your marketing budget. Mm-hmm. And that's really the big part. So for us, $15,000 is your initial fee, but then I really want you to have at least $10,000 in your marketing spend to kind of initiate that grand opening. Mm-hmm. And so that's $25,000. Then you got equipment. If you're going to get a full truck, maybe you're looking at $20,000 by the time you buy equipment and all that sort of thing. So really $50,000 for us is a starting point. Mm-hmm. If someone wants to grow a lot faster, start with two trucks, a couple employees, right, looking at more like 80, 90, 100,000 to really make sure you have that cushion for cash.
Tell us what's happening on this particular job site and kind of the tools that are being used.
Yep, absolutely. So this one, this particular customer is actually up in Canada. They're not here today. Mm-hmm. And so they're actually going to take pictures of this property when they're done and send them to the client.
Okay.
So you can see it's basically a general property cleanup. You can see he's pulled all the weeds out of here. He's deadheaded the hydrangeas. So the hydrangeas usually in the winter get these dead flowers. And so cutting all of those off.
It's part of the cleanup.
Pull all the weeds out. He's gonna be getting all these leaves out. You can see he's using this as a stick edger, it's called.
Yeah, is that for the edging?
Exactly. So by the end of today, the last thing he'll do is clean up these edges, make them really tight. But you can see today he's pulled out a lot of debris out of here. He'll blow all of this stuff back into the bed.
Okay.
But we can go see Aaron, see what he's kind of up to.
Yeah.
But yeah, just a kind of overall general cleanup is what they're shooting for today.
All right, you guys follow us. I'll show you everything that's going on.
All cool, right. So yeah, back here we're doing a leaf cleanup. You can see we've raked all of the leaves out of the beds, and then we'll obviously haul this out of here. And so just kind of clean up the beds. This one's already been cleaned up, deadheaded the bushes, trimmed the bushes up a bit. But Aaron's doing a great job of kind of getting the leaves out of the beds right now.
Okay. And you just got the blower. So really you got a couple pieces of equipment to get a 4-hour job done.
Yeah, it's kind of like back to what we talked about with Nick. Like to get started, you don't need big equipment. You don't right. need lots of machinery. This cleanup's being done with equipment that's probably less than $1,000. Mm-hmm. And so this is a great place to start. And then you can grow and build if that's something you want
to
do.
Yeah, I like to point out to our viewers what you always said. Like you don't even have to have equipment. You can rent it, mm-hmm, right? Or even the idea of go out and get a deposit from the client.
Start small, you know?
Right.
Like at the end of the day, we're selling labor. We're saving the client time.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we need to just pull some weeds or rake out the beds or trim a few bushes, that doesn't require a lot of machinery and equipment and trucks and office and all the rest of it. So when it comes to getting started, definitely this is something anyone can do.
What do you mean by creating systems that let you run a business without you? I mean, I'm sure every entrepreneur is dying to hear that.
Yeah, a lot of times when we think about building a business, we think about the exit in terms of being a sale,
mm-hmm,
where you sell the business and you live happily ever after, you retire, whatever it might be. It can really be a retirement tool almost, or you don't have to work there every single day and get that residual income, that profit still coming in. But to do that, you can't be locked into the day-to-day operations. You can't be locked into having to show up at the office at a certain time. But to do that, you have to have a great team and you have to have great systems. And so when we talk about systems, you know, Command Center is a system. It's something that someone can quickly plug into and not need an office person, not need to go find a leased office space. You know, have an office like this and beanbags for us, mm-hmm, to talk on. Like, they don't have to worry about that. That's a system. A system like we talked about with the trucks and the trailers. Those are all systems to make sure that I don't have to be there. If I can simplify things and make it all run on systems, I don't have to be there juggling all the balls because, mm-hmm, the balls are being held by other people. And so allowing other people that are great, delegating tasks to them, and then allowing them to use the systems allows me to not have to be there every single day managing every single task and every single project and every single decision in the business.
We've got great staff working with you. I mean, we've been interviewing you a number of times, and people are just amazing and wonderful. So I think it'd be important to understand, how do you find top-tier people? Currently, what do you pay them on average, maybe? Mm-hmm. And there's any other tips and tricks and suggestions on getting the right team in place?
Yeah, like, in my opinion, everyone as owners and entrepreneurs, we always are asking, like, how can we get our employees to think like owners? Like, think like us. Mm-hmm. Like, when I go to mow a lawn, I'm making sure it's perfect. I'm making sure I do it quickly and efficiently. There's not waste. How do we get our employees to think like that? Whether it's mowing a lawn, whether it's answering a phone call, whether it is, you know, building a sandwich at Subway, whatever mm-hmm. that is, how do we make our employees think like owners? And in my opinion, there's two things you must do. One, the employee must be compensated like an owner. And two, they must have the information like an owner.
Training?
So, well, no, the information side is really the open book management, mm-hmm. and that is seeing the numbers. Like, mm-hmm. the only reason I can be so efficient or do a lot of things is because I know the numbers. So if I'm not going to share the revenue, share the hourly rates, what we're charging customers to my employees, how can I expect them to make educated decisions on their daily tasks? And that ties right into the second part, which is the compensation side of things. Mm-hmm. And we really try to use P4P as much as possible, pay for performance, instead of an hourly wage. Mm-hmm. So our hourly wage or our base pay on P4P minimum might be $15 to $18 an hour.
Okay.
Not very high. But then giving them a percentage of the revenue that they bring to the business allows them to make more. And that's really where we focus on, along with Wonderful. Profit sharing, where they get a piece of that as well.
Sounds like simplicity and systems should be married, right? Because when you talk about systems, it's not a complicated process. It's simple, 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 and even more simpler. So give us more examples in your business, franchising, local locations, of simplifications, systems that really allow the business to run itself.
Well, you think about, like, it's so important to simplify because it's easier to systematize simple things.
Right.
If I'm trying to systematize a car, for example, there's a lot of work that goes in, a massive amount of engineering, all the rest of it. If I'm trying to systematize how I get, you know, coffee in the morning, that's very simple and therefore very easy to systematize. I can push a button and have it made for me at a certain time if I get the right type of coffee maker. So when it comes to systems, if you can simplify things, it's easier to make that system. And so some examples, a lot of times you want to systematize the things that are really taking your time as the owner away from the things that are actually moving the business forward. So in my mind, marketing and developing your team is the thing that moves the business forward. Okay. Everything outside of that should be delegated and should have a system that runs it instead of you as the owner.
What's the most valuable business lesson you've learned in the last year?
Honestly, I think with 2020 and everything that happened with the pandemic, I learned that taking risk in America is rewarded. Mm-hmm. And the reason I say it is because when, like, the stimulus package came out, the employee got $1,200. You look at business owners, literally gotten the PPP loan, the EIDL. If you look at people who invested in real estate, they got forbearance. Mm-hmm. If you look at the stock market, literally buying out billions and billions of dollars worth of junk bonds to support those investors. So in my opinion, the person who took risk was the one who really won in 2020. And I think it just reinforces the fact that taking risk in America is the smartest thing to do as a business owner.
Awesome. That's a great lesson. To wrap this up, you guys, Mike's got something special for just our UpFlip viewers. And I'll let Mike share more about that. So,
yeah, you know, we kind of talked about, like, the importance of learning and educating, and, like, we have the podcast that's free and lots of stuff, content, learning. We also have landscapebusinesscourse.com. And okay. I remember still typing in Landscape Business Course when I was first starting, trying to learn. And so now on landscapebusinesscourse.com, for all of your viewers, we want to give a special discount to you guys, 25% off. Just go to landscapebusinesscourse.com. When you sign out, the coupon code is UPFLIP25.
Awesome. Thank you, Mike. It's been a pleasure.
My pleasure, brother.
Thank you. Well, that's a wrap for today, you guys. I hope you really, really enjoyed it. Remember what Mike said. It's always easier to systematize simple things. So take something difficult and make it a lot more simpler. Make sure you like this video, subscribe to our channel if you haven't already, and make sure you check out all our other revenue-generating videos from UpFlip. Thank you for watching.